Well, good morning, everybody, or good afternoon or good evening, wherever you happen to be. Welcome to the third installment of Clipple's ongoing live webinar sessions. We're really thankful and happy that you're here today and hope you're healthy and well. Today's webinar is entitled Drawing Meaningful Conclusions from 3D Output Measurements. We will discuss speaker directivity, polar plots, radiation balloons, how we measure them, and why they are important to you and me. Personally, I've spent the majority of my career being concerned about directivity, designing and specifying speaker systems for performing arts centers, sports facilities, houses of worship, many others. So I need to know the directivity, not only at one frequency, but especially at low frequencies and due to highly reverberant environments. We want as much of that sound and as low as possible on the people and not on the walls. You know this. However, there are probably many of you listening right now that are on smaller systems. Maybe you manufacture them. Maybe it's on your desktop. Don't you want to know how the amplified material gets to your customer's ears? I think that's a good idea. Okay, let's get to it. You don't need to hear me ramble on too much. Before we begin, we always like to do a little bit of housekeeping. Feel free to engage in the polling. That's kind of fun. Those results are anonymous, but they're very informative, and they're very interesting to look at and broaden our knowledge. If you can also locate your chat window, you'll see in the chat window, if you have a general question, you can mark that chat as a question. That helps us kind of keep track of them during the Q&A portion. So finally, I am always honored and pleased to announce our handsome and knowledgeable experts on the subject, Dr. Wolfgang Clipple and Mr. Christian Bellman. Take it away, fellas.
Thanks, Kent. Before I start with our topic today, I would like to say some words about the total webinar series. We have already two sessions. I started actually with the modern audio equipment needs output-based testing. That's a new way described in the IEC standard. And in the second session, we did some measurements in a normal room to explore a lot of data. Actually, in 7 minutes, we got already the main information, and to make a very precise measurement, it took us about 20 minutes. But you see, today we are speaking about the results, but later on, every week, we are using this information to make measurements exactly in this room here. That means I will calibrate more or less this setup here for free field, far field condition. And then we are doing all the kind of distortion measurements and even some perceptual measurement just in this room here. Okay, so that was the first day, just principles of output-based measurements. The main idea is here that it is not important what kind of input channel you are using. It is not important how the gain controllers are in the active system. We are primarily based on the output, and we can calibrate any input channel. We do that the next time. Yeah, that was the second session, just the practical measurement with the near-field scanner. Christian showed that here in a very short time, in 7 minutes, we got already almost perfectly the sound power response and the here's the on-axis response up to 8 kilohertz or something like that. Okay, now let's come to the third session. Here it's about interpreting the results and drawing meaningful conclusions from the 3D output. What means that? We would like to speak first about the conventional standard measurement techniques, how to fulfill the requirements. Here, the far field directivity is actually the most common way to see that. That's very important for professional application, for line arrays and so on. And then a very interesting thing is to get meaningful data for consumer home application in a shorter measurement time, but getting the mean information out of that. This same can be applied for listening zones defined maybe on my left and my right ear, and just to get a mean value, which is nice to evaluate the performance of a laptop or a smartphone. Yeah, and finally, we say I would like to say some words about the new way of having beam steering from loudspeakers and using more or less a primary data from a measurement to improve the DSP processing for that. Yeah, now the first poll to everybody. Is the loudspeaker directivity relevant for your work? Here's a different options always. Depends on the particular application. Not really. Please use here the poll, and I'm very interested about the result. The first question to my coworkers: do you think this is interesting for you, Christian?
I can give you an answer, yes, because this belongs really much to my work when working on the NearFit scanner. Yeah, but also just from my personal experience, it makes a difference listening to a loudspeaker if I have maybe just by design a wide directivity or a more narrow one.
Can you show please the results from the poll? Yes, I see it also. So that means always is more than the majority, 62%, and from time to time 32, and not really, that's quite an astonishing, only 4% of our attendees. So that's a good news. Let's go on here with my recording. What are the conventional directivity measurements? Here we are using usually turntables. That's quite nice for speakers. They are not so expensive. If we spend some more money, maybe we have a microphone array at a certain distance to speed up the measurement time. But anyway, in a normal way, as a angular resolution, what we get as a result depends on the number of measurement points. So that means if you would like to improve or to get 5 degrees of angular resolution, you end up with over 2,000 measurement points. So if it takes 5 to 10 seconds, then you know it is already something. But for many applications, that's not sufficient, especially for professional application. And if you need 2 degrees of resolution, then you are more than 60,000 points, which is quite challenging. That might be one day or even more. And 1 degree is actually already not practical. You see, this approach, that the angular resolution comes directly from the measurement, from the scanning, more or less sampling here the angular space, that's a quite time-consuming action. Our next question, how much angular resolution would you need for your application? I think, of course, only on-axis data, that's maybe good for some measurements like distortion measurements, but maybe you need a few measurement points at selected angles. I know 30 degrees is quite popular of axis, or you are using your turntable and turning your speaker only in one direction, maybe on the vertical and on the horizontal axis, and you get two polar plots. That's another option. Or you do more precise measurements with at least 5 degrees resolution or better, 2 degrees. Please put your responses to that. I see already that we can end that. That we have the majority needs or it is sufficient to have at least 5 degrees of resolution. Yeah, but there are a few of them, 13%, who need a better resolution for, I think, for pro. And it's interesting, only 2% are completely happy with a precise on-axis measurement. Yeah, and for the 30 degree, including that are 20%. And what is also very convenient, turning the speaker from the vertical to the horizontal position, that's about 27%. Okay. What about the linear interpolation between the points? So you have your measurement points, it is sampled, and you draw more or less a line between the points with the amplitude and with the phase. There are some paper published, for instance, from Jörg Panzer, for doing that in the right way to minimize the error in the phase response. But here you see what you get if you have an angular sampling with 20 degree. It works completely fine for the horizontal polar plot because the directivity pattern is not so sophisticated, not so complicated, but it looks already a little bit strange or unusual for the vertical plot of this line array. Here at 10 degree angular resolution, we get already a glimpse of the final polar pattern for the vertical direction. And the horizontal polar plot is a little bit more precise here on the rear side, but there is not a big change here on the front side. So that means it works already for the horizontal direction, but it is not very precise for the vertical direction. It is becoming better for the 5 degree resolution, but what is interesting is that here on axis we have a very, very sharp decay of the sound pressure for small angles. That is maybe not realistic. And if you are going to 1 degree resolution, then you see that's the expected behavior for the high steering here on the vertical direction. And then we see the side lobes also at sufficient accuracy. This is one reason why some people say we need at least 1 or 2 degree resolution. Yeah, that means the linear complex interpolation between sparse points, if the angular resolution from the measurement is not so good, is a little bit dangerous. You might have a very bad error. You may miss completely some side lobes here. And you get no warning that something is wrong with your measurement. That's one problem. What about the holographic scanner? Here, I summarize that. Here we do a scanning in the near field. We have a double layer scanning. So that means at a closer distance to the loudspeaker and a little bit more far away. We need a certain amount of points when we start. And then we check actually the accuracy of our modeling of the sound field output. We can do it by using some redundancy in the measurement data. So we have usually 50% or 20% more points than we need for doing our expansion. And we are checking on the other points whether our data are correct. That is more or less what the fitting error is telling us. And if the fitting error is down below 1%, then we know everything is fine, and we can trust this data. Yeah, here we are using here basic functions that are the solutions of the differential equation that are spherical harmonics and Hankel functions. And the most primitive solution is more or less here. That's the wrong order. That's a monopole. Sorry, that are the dipoles, that are the quadrupoles. And you see with higher complexity, the spherical harmonics become more sophisticated. But what is our result? The fitting error, quite important to check the quality of the measurement and the coefficients. So that means for each solution, we need one complex coefficient. That are our results. And now we can do our direct sound extrapolation. That means we are going backwards, more or less, with the basic function and are predicting the sound pressure output. But before we are doing that, here are some examples how we can decompose more or less the sound pressure output from a woofer. That's here measured, here a polar plot at 200 Hertz. It's almost omnidirectional, but we have a little bit more output here on the front side, a little bit less on the rear side, but it's not very complicated. And you see already the monopole solution explains a lot of the behavior. Our error is quite small, so that means the first monopole explains almost 100% of the data below 100 Hertz. Here at 200 Hertz, we see a small difference, and that can be much better explained by using the dipoles. And if we are also considering the quadrupoles, here's the blue ones, then we are usually at a very high accuracy. So that is true for a woofer. And with the order of 10, maybe we don't need that here at lower frequency. So we can live actually with 16 coefficients. No, that's not much. Usually we have here 30 measurement points as a redundancy to check the error. Yeah, now the interesting thing, our final angular resolution depends on the complexity of the loudspeaker. If we have only here a vented box system, that's maybe very close to a dipole behavior, at least for very low frequencies. So we have a source of positive volume velocity on the woofer and another source here at the port with negative volume velocity, and we get this polar plot more or less from this configuration at low frequencies. And the interesting thing is that this behavior can be described by one solution of the wave expansion by the dipole. But it is required that this expansion point is just at the right position between the two centers here of the two positive and negative monopoles, also just in the middle of the dipole. And we need, of course, that's more or less the acoustical center for this configuration. And we need the right alignment. So that are the dipoles in the other axis in maybe Y and Z. And that here is the X axis. Yeah, that's it. And what you see, we get already the perfect angular resolution just from one single dipole, more or less from a few measurement points, maybe 3 or 5. That's it. Yeah, that means for woofer, usually we have much less coefficients. For a line array, we need much more. We are using the constant basic function, Hankel functions, and spherical harmonics, and then we can predict the sound field with a complexity according to the particular device. So that's quite nice. No? And that makes a big difference between the new measurement technique and the standard measurement. Here you see it. This is here the conventional measurement, and here's the holographic one. So the sound pressure measurement is here a direct sampling, and that gives you the result. Where is the microphone? That determines your transfer function. Here we do a scanning of the sound field, but those points will be processed by some wave field expansion. Yeah, to create simulated free field condition, that means perfect free field condition, like in a perfect anechoic room, we can use in the conventional measurement technique windowing. And usually we are doing that. We have spoken already about that. This is a little bit restricted to higher frequencies. With the holographic measurements, we have actually, we are using two techniques. At lower frequencies, we use direct sound separation. So we have actually a Hankel function. This is our speaker again. And the Hankel function of the second kind describes the outgoing wave. And then we have another Hankel function describing the incoming wave. And by doing so, we need a double layer scan, also two points with a different distance from the loudspeaker. No? But with that, we can do a very nice wave separation. We have spoken about this in the last section. At higher frequencies, we prefer windowing. It works quite nice. It's a very fast measurement. Yeah. Next, for the conventional modeling or measurement, no model is required, or a very simple one. You are in the far field. You assume that the 1 divided by R law is valid. Here we need a very complex spherical wave model, but that is implemented in software. It can be handled on normal PCs. So it is an easy way to implement and to use that. What are the results? Here with a conventional measurement, it's the sound pressure depending on the angles and usually a constant distance. Here with the spherical wave model, you get, of course, with the extrapolation, the sound pressure at any point in the 3D space, at any distance from the speaker, but we should be outside the scanning surface. If this is here against the speaker, that is a double layer scan, we have only data here on this side. Or what is very convenient, and I believe that's the future, just storing the coefficients and giving to customers just a set of the weighting coefficients. They are complex frequency responses, but weighting the spherical harmonics. That's a very convenient way. You need not much data. Maybe later on, or Christian, can you give me a number of how much megabytes do you usually have for some speakers?
Well, maybe if we're talking about line array, you start from the raw measurement data with 500 megabytes, so 1,000 impulse responses. But in the end, it goes down to 10 to 20 megabytes or less, just the coefficients finally for this.
Here you see already we are using for the accuracy in the angular resolution more or less the solution from the wave equation. And we have only scaling factors. That's the whole idea. Yeah, I told you already in the conventional measurement, the resolution is limited by the number and placing of the measurement points. And here you get a much higher resolution finally by doing the right interpolation, just using the solution from the wave modeling. Yeah, you are limited in the conventional measurement to the far field. You have to ensure that. We are speaking about this very soon. But with the holographic measurement, you can also go to the near field, to the far field. It doesn't matter. With the redundancy in the sampling, with a holographic measurement, we can always check whether your data are accurate. And this is a very nice self-test. This is not really possible from the conventional measurement. Okay, now let's go on to the far-field directivity pattern. Here you see only two selected axes in blue and in green here on this laptop. If here I'm operating the two speakers here of the laptop in mono, I get a quite complex directivity pattern, but we can easily handle that here with a near-field scanner. But you see already it's a lot of data. And to interpret that, what is good, what is bad, that's not simple. This is now the next goal in our webinar, to show you a little bit how to derive and extract the most important data, which are meaningful for everybody. No? Yeah, that are here the two speakers. And of course, you can look here to the balloon plot, and there are many, many ways to present that. Christian give you a practical demo very soon. And now I'm coming back an idea I think is from Floyd Toole or Jean Olive. It's anyway a very good idea. They said for normal home audio devices for hi-fi loudspeakers. I think it's more than 10 years old. We need not all the data from the dry activity. Here are the important data. And they are actually, of course, the on-axis response, which is usually quite flat. And we are averaging actually the responses in a listening window. And we assume that we are averaging here only a few points, and that represents more or less that where the listener is located. Maybe he and his wife and the children. So it's not very narrow, maybe for some people. Yeah, and then we should check how is the behavior of the loudspeaker activating the room reflections. And here, first, the early reflection, that means only the reflection on one wall, maybe the ceiling, the ground floor, you see it here in this way. That's a reflection on the ceiling. That's a reflection maybe here on the ground floor and maybe on the walls here. On the left and right walls. Yeah, and then the traditional way of integrating the responses over 4π, all angles, they are doing that a little bit more simple. They are using only the horizontal measurement and the vertical one, but this is maybe a good approximation for this case. That's an estimation for the sound power response here. Usually the sound power goes a little bit down because the loudspeaker is steering at higher frequencies. So here it's flat, then we are losing some sound power. Yeah. There are some relative measures which more or less checks the difference to the on-axis, that's the early reflection distance here. And of course, the directivity index, that's more or less on-axis response divided by the sound power response, that's this distance here. That's very well known. Okay, now the next poll. I'm very interested about the result. You know this kind of spinogram, the integral values, they are defined here in the CEA standard. Do you use that for your work? The first one, no, I don't use that. The second one, I use this sound power. The third one, directivity index. I have to say, second and third, they are defined for many years. They are very popular. The listening window, is already at 21%. Are they published the result? No, maybe we can publish this now. Here you see the result. That's what I expected. That's the directivity index because it's a simple number. It's one curve. It's very popular. I like it also very much. The sound power is a little bit less. And then comes, I assume the people who are working with normal conventional speakers, they measuring the listening window, but with 20%, almost 20% is also a lot. And the early reflection, much less. Kent, you would like to say something?
Well, I just wanted to chime in. Some people are asking if there are more than one answer to these.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely.
For example, estimated in-room response and obviously, in a situation like this, you can use a number of these to determine, what the speaker is telling you.
Yes. Of course, I think nobody will only measure the directivity index and will never measure the on-axis response. That should be quite rare. let's go on. But you have already a feeling how popular the different things are. Yeah, now the next question, near field or far field response, that's already quite a big question that depends on the size of the speaker. We have spoken about this in the last webinar. It's very clear. If you have a very large loudspeaker, you should select a larger distance. But it depends also on the frequencies. Here we have a fixed frequency that's 500 hertz. Usually it becomes worse at a lower frequency, 50 hertz and something like that. You need a larger distance. Yeah, but what is interesting, here we don't see this the sound pressure, we see the sound power, and actually the apparent sound power. So that means we are considering also the case when pressure and velocity of the sound particles are not in phase, yeah, if they are working out of phase, then we have an apparent power. That happens in the near field. In the far field, they are in phase, and our power is almost constant. That's very close to the sound intensity. That means integrated with the area, you get your power. Yeah, and here you see that the apparent sound power is rising, and rising according to the order of the wave quite rapidly. The monopole has a nice feature that is always constant for any distance, even in the near field. You could say there is no near field for the monopole. That's right. And if you remember to the last webinar, Don Kiel's technique worked quite nicely for a monopole. For subwoofers, where the port is sealed, so enclosed, the driver enclosed boxes. That's more or less the idea that you have no near field properties. But already with a dipole, it is rising. And if you need higher order spherical harmonics to describe the complex directivity pattern, it becomes quite, I would say, dangerous to go to the near field, because those higher order waves may rise from the mass quite dramatically to lower frequencies. That is here 250 dB, that's 150 dB. You see that's absolutely poisonous here, this region. But usually with a scan, we are here larger than, I forgot to say that, that's not frequency, look to that, that's distance. That's 10 centimeters, that's 1 meter, and that's 10 meter. So here more or less, we are for 500 hertz, we are on the far field, all the spherical harmonics are flat. And here we are going to the, or we are in the near field. And now it depends how strong is the contribution of each wave to the total one. Yeah, so here maybe the user, that means how is the contribution of those elements? What happens if the evaluation point is in the near field? Here we have actually a problem, and that's why this situation is not recommended by the IEC standard. But it might happen. For instance, you are comparing different speakers, and you are choosing a very common evaluation distance of 1 meter, which is too short for one or more speaker. Maybe a professional speaker where the far field starts at 3 or 8 meter. Then we have two solutions. First of all, we declare the true measured level here at this evaluation point, and to state that's not far field condition, you cannot apply the 1 divided by R law. The other solution is, you are calculating an assumed far field SPL level, alpha, which is only a reference to this distance RE. How can you do that? You are doing the measurement in the far field, and or you're using an holographic measurement to calculate the far field sound pressure, and then you apply the 1 divided by RE law and calculate the near field, assumed near field value, which is an assumed far field level. If you do the measurement, you find a discrepancy to reality, but you can apply the 1 divided by R law and get a correct far field pressure. Okay, now Paul, are the near field properties relevant for your work? Maybe there are some application where you can easily say no, but maybe there are some other cases. Your listening zone is in the near field. You are working with personal mobile audio devices, studio monitors, and something like that. Or the other case, the loudspeaker size is usually so big and your room is so small that you have always this problem that you are losing maybe some dBs. We will see it quite practically here on the small smart speaker, how much it is. Or maybe you have here you have other reason for not doing that. So the results, I see it already. They are quite nicely distributed. Please open that. So it's not a problem for 30%, as I assumed. It is for modern devices. It is a problem, clearly. And of course, for all the guys in Pro who need precise data. Yeah. And there, I'm very much interested. What are the other reasons? Maybe you can use here the chat for sharing that with us. Maybe I go on and later on, Kent will share this with us. Okay. Now let's exploit the comprehensive 3D information here on a laptop in the near field, far field. It's a near field, so we have some near field effects. That's the left ear, that's the right ear. You can easily calculate that even at a later time, at any time, you are using your coefficients from the scan, you can extrapolate that immediately. It takes some seconds. You will see it from Christian. Yeah. Of course, you can check the whole distribution. Now we are looking from above on the here on our laptop and seeing outside the scanning surface. This is important, the data. Inside, it is not possible. And we can also animate that. So that's that. And now, comparing the distance at half a meter and 2 meters, that means in the far field, there should be only a constant distance in dB. According to doubling the distance at 6 dB. But here you see easily that we have significant difference at some frequencies. That's sometimes here 5 dB and more. We are coming to that in the practical measurement. So that's quite normal. And here you see versus the distance animation, how the sound pressure decays. That's here the amplitude and that's the front propagation. Another way is to say, I'm not so much interested in a particular point. Please average the behavior over a certain space. And actually, there is a standard for that, and it's a very good idea. Here you can define some volumes, and you can easily calculate the mean value and the variance also in such a space. That's here in front of that. That's a little bit off X on the real side, and here on the left and on the right side. So you are applying some statistics more or less to your space and averaging your sound pressure response. So we say actually goodbye to the normal far field angular behavior. We are really calculating a mean value for a certain area. That's quite interesting. Yeah, the next poll, do you use TSP for generating a desired directivity pattern of your speaker? That means you're doing some kind of beam steering and something like that. Please tell us, yes, I do that in a primitive way, just for two transducers. I used Don Keel's technique to use a crossover to get the best directivity pattern open, also in the transfer region, just in the mean region between woofer and tweeter and above. Yeah, I use this for stereo system, and I use this for beamforming and beam steering. Well, that's quite interesting. It's you see for stereo system, it's actually not really required. I agree. Only 10% are doing that, and for the other applications, we are very very similar, about 30%. So it makes sense if you make a good job to tune or to use the different positions of the tweeter and the woofer and the crossover and the freedom which you have in DSP to get a very nice interactivity pattern. And it is, of course, 100% crucial if you are working with beamforming and beam steering. Okay, and now we are here more or less at the end. Think about you are in the modern time on a modern device. You spend a lot of money on transducers, on hardware. You have some DSP processing capabilities. You are placing the transducers very tight here in a box, as tight as you can. And now you would like, if you measure the speaker separately here in the line array, you get a very complicated behavior, at least at higher frequencies. And now you would like to tune the directivity pattern over the intended audio band. And now we need actually to fit the final speaker. With the DSP tuning, we need actually a lot of scanning time and a lot of coefficients, because it is very likely that this loudspeaker finally has a very high beaming and a very sharp characteristic, and we have to pay for that with the complexity of our wave modeling. Yeah, but it is a much better idea to measure actually each transducer separately. So that means disactivating for a moment the other speakers and doing the wave, the spherical wave modeling for each transducer separately. And then we overlay the responses from the loudspeaker, and maybe also we are considering the particular DSP processing for each speaker. And now we see the total behavior. But just by adding the responses. Here you see that's a response from one transducer on the lower side. Yeah, it's more steering to the lower side here. So the diffraction on the line array will also cause that. And now we are adding two of them. It goes into the right direction. Now we have filled, or we are operating half of the speakers, and now we are close to the final, and we get the desired directivity pattern. What is the good? It's much simpler in the measurement. It's much more precise. It goes faster. What is one reason? We can, if we are making the scan separately for each transducer, we are putting the acoustical center, which should be identical with expansion point of the spherical wave expansion, just in the middle of the transducer. And then we can use a minimum of spherical harmonics to describe that. Yeah, and for the DSP guys, that's quite nice. He has done the scanning once. He has this data as a coefficients. Now he can play on his processing and maybe find the best way for tuning his final loudspeaker. So that's just software then. Okay, that should be, let's do a short summary here before we are coming to the discussions. All that is covered in the new IC standard 6268-21, which describes, of course, all the needs from the conventional directivity measurements, makes a very clear definition of position and something like that, and the new techniques for assessing the complete 3D sound output, that means at different distances. We refer to the holographic measurement. We are using the spherical harmonics, but theoretically you can use other expansions, cylindrical or plane waves. There are many ways for doing that. Yeah, the spherical wave expansion is very well suited for loudspeakers, especially in the far field. It gives you a very good maximum resolution by a minimum number of coefficients and measurement time, also sampling points. It provides a self-check. That's quite nice. That's important. It is very much recommended to think about useful simplified, accumulated integral values, which are collecting the most important information. I recommend the sound power response. Many people are doing that. We have seen that. The directivity index, also very useful, of course, on access. And then maybe for stereo loudspeakers, we have already a very good proposal by Floyd Toole. But for smartphones and other things, maybe we get some other standards very soon where we have very meaningful, simple integral numbers, curves, one curve, which tells us a lot about the device. Yeah, think about mean values, variances in the sound field to see how nicely distributed is the sound is in the intended listening zone. That's also quite very valuable. And of course, for DSP processing, then you will enjoy the coefficients, a small number of data, and you can nicely predict the sound pressure at any point in the far field outside the scanning surface. So that's it. Now we have, before we come to the end, we have time for some discussion. No, Christian is, it's Christian's turn. Sorry. Oh.
What am I doing here?
we can also start with a bit. Okay. So I take over. So there we go. So I want to do with you now a little bit on the practical side. So maybe if you remembered from last week, we measured this small black box. So we used analog input. So we had measured this just as an active speaker, our active system. And I will go to the database, DBLab. So this is my screen, and maybe I start where we finished last week. So we had did a near-field scan with of the speaker, and we used our field separation to get at first a clean free field response in the near field of the loudspeaker. So this is the response of the loudspeaker in front in 12 centimeter distance, what was a point of the measurement surface. But finally, this is maybe not the data we are interested. We've seen from the polls that for most of you, you need the far field data, and there are good reasons for comparing speakers in the far field. And now we want to check what we can get out of this coefficients data, which we have identified with this module. For this, I have another operation here, which is doing for me all the calculations. So I'm now transforming back my coefficients into sound pressure. So running the module, I will get a graphical user interface where I now can do all my settings, my analysis. I have here some parameters which I can modify, so I can change the distance, I can change angle resolution, and can go to different listening points. But at first, we will start with the simple curves, so which are very important. We also saw it from your polls that we actually want to know the sound power of the loudspeaker. I'm now calculating this live from our coefficients. So sound power is shows how the energy of the loudspeaker, which is radiated, so the integral value of the sound pressure of all radiation directions. Another maybe most important curve is the on-axis response. I will also calculate this here. So I calculated this now for 10 meters, so where I expect for this small speaker, it should be really a far-field curve. And then maybe the third curve I want to calculate is the directivity index, which more or less combines the information between the sound pressure and the sound power. Just wait for the calculation. You see it running here. Okay. So now I have also the directivity index. So this was the first calculation I did. I will save this panel now, and we will go into the DBLab software. We have our curves right in here. So talking about directivity, it always shows a relation between maybe the total output of a loudspeaker and the response at particular points. And especially when we're thinking about the directivity index, it's a comparison of the on-axis response and the radiated sound power. I will now just copy the Farfield response here into the sound power window. I mean, you see at the moment a mismatch in the level. This is expected because I'm really far away and this SPL drops already. But I can also align this here just with some shift settings that we can compare the relative shape of the curves. So I make it big. So what we see here that for low frequencies, the curve shape is almost identical. That means that the sound pressure on axis has almost the same value like the integrated sound pressures over the complete sphere. So the loudspeaker is radiating on axis in the same way as the average of all other directions. For higher frequencies, we see that the on-axis sound pressure for this loudspeaker is much higher than the sound power. So that means it actually radiates more to the on-axis direction. So we have some kind of beaming to the on-axis. And especially this information is now represented in the directivity index. So if we have a look at this, the directivity index summarizes this information. So we have the information of the main direction compared to the rest of the radiation. And for low frequencies, we see that we are here at zero, that we have almost a zero here, so 0 dB directivity index, very long range. So here the speaker is a monopole. We have an omnidirectional radiation. And then if the frequency rises, we're also getting a more distinct beaming to the front. So a positive directivity index, more output on axis than off axis. The directivity index can be also negative. For example, if you have a cancellation on axis, maybe because of a weird cone vibration, then it can also have a negative value here. Okay, so far I'm getting already from this three curves some information about my loudspeaker. I can get an idea how my loudspeaker is beaming, but actually I'm not seeing the details. And for further analysis and development of my loudspeaker with directivity, I also want to see the details. We can also do this, and common far-field characteristics here are contour plots, balloon plots, polar plots. Wolfgang has already mentioned this, but now we will have a look at this for this particular speaker. I'm back to my channel here, my control channel, and a good plot to start is the contour plot. I will calculate this contour plot because it is already a 3D plot, which gives me the information of the sound pressure over the frequency and also over the off-axis angle. I calculate this now for the vertical one. So how my radiation changed from the top to the bottom and like this. And I'm in the end getting a plot like this, which has here a frequency axis and here is a theta angle. And theta means 0 degree, theta means on axis. And then if I'm 30 degree off axis, I'm at the top 30 degree and minus 30 degree means below. And 180 degree, I'm just behind. Okay. And from this plot, I can already see some more details how my loudspeaker behaves over the frequency. For low frequencies, you see this almost vertical lines. The color shows the sound pressure. Red means loud, blue means quiet, in short. And we see we have almost the same sound pressure for all radiation angles. If we go to higher frequencies, then we see how the loudspeaker starts lobing. So on axis is louder than off axis. Another interesting thing, which is also defined in standards, is that we can derive from isobars from this plot just some coverage angle of the loudspeaker, which make then finally the data easier to compare. I can calculate this by using the beamwidth plot, and now I see some lines where at which angles the SPL drops by a certain by a certain dB. So the inner line is 6 dB. And if we look at 2 kilohertz here, we have maybe a coverage here of 80 degree, but for 10 kilohertz or above 10 kilohertz, it goes down maybe to 20, 15 dB coverage for this loudspeaker. I go back to the contour plot. And I mean, what's also now interesting, I maybe also investigate a little bit more into the details of a particular frequency. So maybe I can just select different frequencies. Maybe I just go to such a resonance at high frequencies where we see some lobing. And now it would be interesting to see the polar pattern of the loudspeaker here. I can do this, so I can calculate here my polar plot for this speaker now. And this is what I see. I'm having at one point the polar plot I have calculated. And here I have a little checkbox to also show me the 90 degree shifted one. So this is a vertical one. If I activate this, I get the blue one, which is in this case the horizontal polar plot. And also a common visualization is the balloon plot, which now showing me for one frequency the pattern for all radiation angles. So finally, I get a 3D plot out of this that shows me how the loudspeaker is radiating. In this case, at 15K, it's very much beaming to the front and to the back. We are almost 30 dB below the on-axis response. So far, we have done nothing new with our coefficient data. We just calculated the far-field characteristics, which we also would get from each turntable measurement. We just have the benefit that we are not really limited to our sampling at particular angles. We have an interpolation method that can interpolate based on the wave equation. But we also, as Wolfgang explained, we have a correct model that explains how the energy changes from near into far field and how the radiation pattern changes and also the on-axis response changes. So that means I can directly take my small speaker and don't have to assume where the far field starts. I can actually measure where am I in the far field or am I not in the far field. And this I will do now. For this, I go back to my visualization. You will be now already very familiar with the control panel. And this is a big unit thing that I now have. I'm not limited to my measurement range. I have a radius here. And I can go to any radius that is outside my scanning surface to do a calculation. We will start as a reference with our 10-meter response, because I expect for this small speaker, 10 meters should be really in the far field. I'm using here the sensitivity plot because sensitivity is usually always referenced to a distance. And this is in this case 1 meter. So it's just take any response I calculate and just make the 1/r reference to 1 meter. I also added here as a reference voltage 0.1 volt because this was the input voltage I put in the speaker when I was measuring. So in the end, I can really say what is the SPL output of the speaker from my measurement here. Okay. So this was now the curve calculated at 10 meters, and I just will make a copy that we can remember what we have measured here. So I will call this 10 meter and also give it a different color, then it's easier to separate later on. Okay. And now the next thing I want to do is that I will change my distance. So maybe I go very close. I go to 0.3 meters. And if you're in America, this is about 1 foot. So we can do the calculation again and now check if we get the same frequency response or if our curve shape will change because we have a near field effect. So the question is 0.3 meters for this small loudspeaker far field or not? And from the curve shape, we getting an answer, which is yes and no. Because if we have a look maybe between 1 kilohertz and 5 kilohertz, we see the curves are pretty much the same. So we can maybe say for this mid-high frequencies, we are almost in the far field. So maybe making a far field assumption here is not as bad. So anyway, if we look at low frequencies, we see some differences in the curve. So maybe we just pick out a frequency close to the resonance. We can also read the values with the cursor. Here you can see it's now 70.29, so 70.3 about the first curve. And if we go to the other curve, we're at 70.8. So we're around about half a dB difference between in the curve shape between the 30 centimeter measurement and the 10 meter measurement. So the standard defines you are in the far field when the SPL doesn't change more than half a dB. So we're really at the border to can do if to be conform with the standard. But we also see some difference in high frequencies. Here maybe a strange radiation mode is happening on the cone membrane, or we see some diffractions from the cabinet that they can really cause some kind of more complex directivity pattern. And here finally we see a bit more difference, so we're maybe 1.5 dB up to 2 dB difference here. But it means if we measure in 30 centimeters and we assume a far field condition, this will be the systematic error that we would make. And then it's a kind of decision if you want to live with this error, or maybe you will you have to compensate for this error. Maybe I will do another curve. So maybe just copy the 30 centimeters curve in here. It's a different color. And now maybe we go directly to 1 meter and see what's happened there. Same story, changing the distance, starting the calculation. And then then we will see if 1 meter is in the far field, or if we also see still some changes from 1 meter to 10 meter, maybe. Okay. So 1 meter is now our red curve. And if we compare this to the green curve, then we see for this small loudspeaker, 1 meter is still a little bit different. We see some minor near field effects, but probably you can say 1 meter is far field for this loudspeaker. Okay. Especially when you're having near field applications like a laptop or a studio monitor and you're really close to the loudspeaker, maybe this is quite interesting for you what's happened if you're in the near field. So finally, based on the theoretical harmonics, we not can just calculate a single curve. We also can get a little bit more sophisticated data out of this, so we can really see how our sound field is in the near field. We can also do this with the software. I mean, what you see now is here that I had placed my speaker here, and the sphere you see around is our basically the representation of our measurement surface. So this is the minimum radius where we can predict data. And now I can just put a projection plane right into that, which is now a projection plane of 8 by 8 meter with a loudspeaker in the center. And we can actually check how the sound field is for this speaker for a particular frequency. Again, recalculating everything live from the coefficients, but we should have a result soon. So this is what we get now from this. So in the end, we can generate a huge amount of data and any crazy visualizations what we have in mind. So maybe this is really funny for the marketing guys, but we as an engineers, we like single values and we also like simple curves, because this gives us a good measure really to compare a loudspeaker. I think it would be very different if you have 5 different units, you're looking at this plot and you try to find out the differences. But if you can put it down to a curve that gives you a single number, you can say, okay, this is 1 dB more, 1 dB less, or this has a weird resonance and this has a dip or whatever. So finally, we can go also the other way around. We can go back from the strange curves, from the 3D representation back to our listening zones. So back to our listening zones. So Wolfgang explained in the lecture already that we have this CEA as a some kind of special example, but it's exactly the same idea. You have a measurement with two polar plots, 72 measurements, I think. And now you will just summarize these amount of data to some curves that let you allow speakers compare easily. We also can do this here because we can now just calculate the frequency response at this particular point and also do the integration as it defined in the standard. So basically, I start with the calculation of some frequency responses, so some horizontal and vertical frequency responses, and this is in the end the data I need for my CEA window. So the summary of these graphs. Here again, a little bit of visualization that you see. I have the listening window in the screen area, some early reflections on the side, top and bottom, and for sure the on axis. I also noticed in the chat that somebody says we didn't put the estimated room response in the poll. And the estimated room response is for sure also here, which finally is an average value of, I hope I say it right, from the on-axis listening window and listening window, early reflections, and sound power. Just weighted to getting a response how the loudspeaker may behave in a normal listening room. Okay, here we are at almost at a spherical coordinate system at some particular angles in the same distance. So almost thinking in the polar plot way with turntable measurement, but we can also make it more open that we say, okay, anyway, in the room, I say, this is my target area. Here is the head of my listener. He should sit here. And this is also fine defined in this other EEC standard, the 62777, which defines some kind of listening zones. And we for sure can easily calculate this for our loudspeaker, that we finally can compare, okay, the people who are sitting in front of the loudspeaker will hear this, and maybe the neighbors, they will disturb like this. So finally, for this speaker, we would say that we can say that maybe the front area is covered quite similar. So the top, bottom, right, and left getting a almost similar frequency response or similar level here. Okay, so this is the point where I now just want to close my practical demo, and maybe we have now time for questions and discussions.
Nicely done, Christian. Thank you very much. Going back, as they say in radio, let's go to the phones. I'm going to roll back to, we don't have too many questions, but I think there's some good ones we can get to here. Originally, one of the questions when we were talking about measurement of monopole and the low frequency, in the order expansion of the port and woofer, it says Klippel took the acoustic center and spoke about the monopole. We know that the acoustic center depends on the frequency. How can we obtain a center position according to frequency to apply those corrections? In other words, how do we determine in the low frequency where the acoustic center point is, and how do we correct for that?
The acoustical center is always a challenging subject. John van der Kooi published some interesting papers about that. We know from that, from his measurement and his theoretical investigation, that actually the acoustical center is a little bit in front of the diaphragm and so on. That's only in this direction. If you have a port and a driver, then it becomes even more complicated. So it is changing with frequencies, and it is sometimes quite difficult to measure that. That means at higher frequencies, you can use the time delay. At lower frequencies, it's better to measure the sound pressure on the rear side, on the front side, and compare the amplitude. You see already it's quite challenging to measure the acoustical center. And maybe, Christian, you have some other examples and experiences from that.
Yes, I agree with Wolfgang and also with John van der Kooi's paper that he really showed that it's for woofer right in front. But the interesting thing is, even if we're not correct with our assumption of the acoustic center, that means for our fitting, we just need more coefficients, so we can have to go lower. We have to invest more orders to compensate for this mismatch of, would say, physics and our calculation system. And there's also, I mean, a paper, it was, I think, 2017, AES where one of our customers used the NeFIT scanner to check how if they come to the same results as WonderCoy. So finally, they took the NeFIT scanner, measured a woofer, put the center point for the spherical expansion somewhere, and finally, in the results, you will get, I mean, the same result as WonderCoy, that if you're looking at the sound field, that the center of the monopole is somewhere in front. So for low frequencies, not critical because you can just invest a few more orders. For high frequencies, it's more critical because then you maybe need already a lot of orders to describe the actual sound field. And in this case, if you be off with your expansion point, that means you need more and more and more to compensate for the small mismatch.
So let's summarize. If you are doing a scan, always put your expansion point to the tweeter. That's a good summary.
I think so, too. That's what we typically default to. One question came in. If you wanted to just measure the on-axis far-field response in a normal listening room using the holographic processing technique and far-field measurements, how many measurements does it take to get a reliable response? And are all measurements done on-axis? I think there might be a little bit of a combination of doing in-room on-axis measurements and maybe some of the Klippel near-field scanner and holographic measurement technique mashed in there.
Well, maybe I answer. I mean, we have also did some research that maybe if it's possible, just putting only the points where we want to measure. But finally, from our research, it showed out that especially for separating the room, we almost need this complete surface, but we just need this for the low frequencies. That's the point. And then if you want to minimize the measurement points and you can go to the position where you can measure, you can make a mix between only taking the spherical harmonics for the low frequencies where you have no chance with windowing and using the windowing for the rest. If you want to do a complete spherical wave expansion, near field, far field compensation, what is expensive are the high frequencies, because here the sound field is getting complex and here you need some measurement points actually.
Right, right. I'd recommend everybody go to the Klippel website. That's Klippel, KLIPPEL.DE, and do a search on the near field scanner. There's plenty of papers there and mathematics that'll help you understand the holographic process a little bit more. Hugo asks us, in the case of a two-way studio monitor, would you recommend to use an adjustment between the B loudness contour, I assume he's talking about weighting, when listening at them at low SPL, and for higher SPL, use a Z loudness contour?
Good question. That's but this is it's a very, that has nothing to do with our particular problem today. We are doing just the measurement. That's actually the perceptual problem. That means I assume what you mean is if you I don't speak about nonlinearities. That's in between. Just skip that. I think you mean if I my listening level is not so loud, I don't hear the bass from just the nonlinearities in my ear, and you would like to use a different weighting of the curves than at louder level, where the perception of the bass is much simpler and much better. Do you mean that?
I think that's the intent. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's always difficult in a listening position or a mixed position, as it were, to calibrate the speaker responses, you know, at a particular pressure level. Moving on, there's a question about
Maybe one comment.
Yeah.
Maybe I have to look here to the paper. It's sixth session, I assume, then we are speaking, or seventh. That's a compression of the fundamental response. But this is a thermal problem, a nonlinear problem, and maybe your DSP is also reducing at lower frequencies, higher frequencies, your response. That's a different story. We are coming back to that in the seventh section.
Right. And I think this applies to our first webinar about output-based measurements in pressure level, which I think is good. There was a question about, are there any acoustic simulation software packages using holographic data? Now, in this instance, we're using DB Lab, which is specific to Klippel. But I think the intent of the question is can you export the holographic data and use it in simulation data? Of course, I use Ease by Honored Feistel Media Group. Shout out to Charlie. Are there any other simulation packages that you can think of that you can bring this holographic data into and use for simulations?
Well, I think the state of the art is the balloon model. That's clear. And for a lot of things, this balloon model is also fine, and we can getting this balloon data out of the spherical harmonics. I don't know of any public software which are using the coefficients, but I know from customers who doing maybe their own stuff with optimizing line arrays, waveguides, that they already having implemented this format. I mean, we can just offer this format and also offer in addition the, I would say, state-of-the-art format, which is outside. But we see a lot of benefits on this. And especially if you're thinking about near-field devices that maybe can give you really a benefit. I mean, it's a little bit of mass, but it's not so much. And maybe if you're using calculation tools like MATLAB, you have most of the basics function already implemented. So it's not that complicated to do it.
Okay, thank you. All right, now is a portion of our webinar where a question comes in to put Wolfgang right on the spot. Are you ready, Wolfgang?
Yes, of course.
What are your preferred speakers that you listen to for enjoyment, and do you know if they measure well?
Actually,
I don't know if we have to divulge types here or brands, but
no. To make it very simple, I played for a long time a self-made speaker, actually with a KTS, using the distortion analyzer, by the way, where I use the DSP and the distortion analyzer also for the music reproduction. So my wife has to operate the distortion analyzer to listen to some music. I could convince her 5 years to bear that. So she was quite fast later on in selecting this mode. Finally, they said, Wolfgang, we have to change that. And of course. And I have collected enough information from the KCS, from the nonlinear control and the linearization. So the experiment was successfully finished. And I decided here, from Neumann from Sennheiser for a studio monitor, but he's so small and so nice and so well made. We measured this guy here in our lab, maybe one of the first speakers, Christian, yeah? And I said, that's it. So it's a half professional equipment, or it's a professional equipment for consumer applications, so it's quite nice.
Right, very good sonic speaker. And so really, just to summarize, is it important to keep the wife filter in or remove the wife filter? Anytime I play speakers and my wife is in the room, she runs. So you must find a speaker that is comfortable for your wife.
Yes, of course. That's okay. The best thing. Yeah, you have to listen always to the wife. That means science and engineering is less important.
We have to say
it in such a way.
But what do you do if your wife is listening music to a smartphone speaker?
Don't ask me.
And you know this song has a good bass line, then it's getting...
No. All right, well, wonderful. That's a wonderful chat. Okay, well, thank you, everybody.
I have some open questions.
Wolfgang still got some more open questions coming.
I would do close up the whole thing.
Right.
Here, so that means for the next seminar or webinar, let's go to that here. We say goodbye to the 3D sound. That's now finished with this webinar, but we are using the data for calibrating the measurement point in 30 centimeter distance in my room. And we are using only the data from the 7-minute scan, also from the very short scan. Yeah, that's actually our topic. And we speak about to compensating different strange things which are not correct in my room. That means the distance is 1 dB wrong. You know it now, 30 centimeters is already in the near field. We have here the small Bluetooth speaker on a big table. So this half space condition, we will correct that. And we have a lot of room reflection. We cope with that. And this with a 7-minute holographic scan. For high frequencies, we are using windowing. And our goal is actually also to compensate those effects. And of course, we are speaking about using that function for other speakers as a kind of a room or setup compensation curve. Also, that means what we are doing on this particular speaker, can we apply it to other speakers? That's our question the next time. So I hope you have enjoyed that. So please be with us in 1 week.
See everybody next week. Thanks for attending.